Okay, so what do we mean by differential imagery experience? Firstly, we're talking about mental imagery, mind's eye experience, not images in public or in the world. And by differential, we mean that the strength or the vividness of mental imagery differs across the population. How do we know this? Psychologists use a standardized questionnaire called the VVIQ. And it's where you're asked to picture something. You can see this example here. There are four other sort of scenarios. And then rate the vividness of what you picture. Each one of these elements here on a scale of 1 to 5, 1 for no image and 5 for as vivid as perception, as real seeing. The test has its critics because it's self-reporting, it's reporting subjective experience, but the results do correlate with behavioural measures. Now when you give this test to a group of people, the results form a bell curve of normal distribution, something like that. So most people are in the middle, experiencing some degree of imagery. At the far extreme are people who experience imagery very vividly in their daily life, as vivid as perception. But at the other extreme are people who entirely lack mental imagery, who gave 1 for every question in those tasks. And they make up about 2 to 3% of the population. So this phenomenon that some people do not experience imagery had been given a little scientific attention until it was given a name, aphantasia, in 2014 by the British neurologist Adam Zeman. And this was publicised in the Popular Science press, and very soon, for the ensuing years, thousands of people, now over 11,000 people, have contacted Zeman to say that they too have aphantasia, that they are aphantasic. Among which, to the researchers' surprise, were many artists. Artists, designers, architects, and writers who could not visualise. So I joined the group to help investigate this phenomenon of creativity without visualisation. And we're doing that by developing an exhibition of artwork by a selection of these people. And that exhibition opens in January next year at Tramway in Glasgow, just to get the plug in there. In this presentation, I want to talk about what we've found in terms of how internal visibility relates to artistic production, and then suggest some historical context for those findings. So, across the 21 participants in the exhibition, which we're including professionals, amateurs, everything in between, we can distinguish certain shared strategies and how they negotiate with this neuropsychological trait. And one of these strategies, as you might expect, is to copy directly from a source, be it an object in front of them or a group of photographs. So this is Daan Twinkhuysen in the Netherlands. He said that although his work does follow the local tradition around Groningen of figurative painting, he feels that his aphantasia, he says, makes him more or less constricted to observation and led to painting in this photorealistic style. So Stephanie Brown is an illustrator in the US, and she draws the contents of her pictures entirely from photographs. She says that she'll take a scene from a story as the initial prompt, but then instead of working with what the scene evokes for her, She'll instead methodically work out what the piece requires. Not only photo references, but also the colours. And she says, with the fall of a king, over this piece, I knew it needed to take place at sunset, due to the story I was basing it on, so I planned to only use warm colours in the scene before I started painting. Even the grass was only painted with a cool yellow, because I thought through the fact that it would look green when surrounded by all the other warm colours. So this is a process of deduction and planning, rather than visualization. So several other aphantasic artists describe themselves as working blind, is a phrase they often come up with. So rather than depending on an immediate reference, they let the image emerge from the picture surface. And this is strikingly the case with Michael Chance here, who's a London-based artist, who paints these elaborate figurative scenes without physical reference material. And I think we've got a video, he's made a time-lapse video of himself working, which I can hopefully show you while I read what how he describes how he works. He says that the lack of ability to visualize images in my mind is a great motivation. I must physically work on a drawing or painting in order for my imagination to become visually manifest. I often start a picture with no intention and certainly no end goal. It materializes in an improvisatory way. The way images, usually figures, emerge from my subconscious is akin to dreaming. However, these visions are also informed by my everyday experience and observational drawing practice, and structured by my artistic understanding of illusionistic space, light, form, and anatomy. He also does less saucy stuff, less that skew your perception of his imaginings. This is Susan Backey in Australia. She employs collage, pre-existing materials combined, altered, and added to a surface. Is another means of working blind without visualizing. But interestingly, this was made in a state of high emotion, she says, in response to the news of the suicide of an acquaintance. She says that although there were no images in my mind of the distressing events, it seems that a figurative representation of them emerged unintentionally, growing from the action of making and the subconscious knowledge of the death of the young man. So for her, there's this kind of therapy taking place. She's giving form to images externally that she could not do internally in the process. To better locate aphantasia, we're also including work by artists on the other side of the bell curve of recorded imagery vividness, and those with what Zeyman has named hyperphantasia. This is closer to kind of photographic memory, right? Now, in terms of experience, to the neurotypical amongst us, this trait appears even stranger. These are individuals who can inspect their mental imagery in a way that others might examine a photograph held in their hands. And this ability leads to particular ways of working. So this is Melissa Campbell in the US, who makes textiles. And she plans the weaving of them entirely in her mind's eye before she starts. She says, my weavings are the result of combining two separate paintings. I spend hours over days or months composing the whole piece in my mind. I visualize the designs, the two separate paintings, make changes, rotate it to check the structures from different angles, and make corrections and adjustments to the design before I put it down on paper. When I finally make the finished piece, the weaving and resulting image come out how I composed them in my mind. This is remarkable. But I think we're less surprised by a hyperphantasic artist than by the notion of a visual artist who cannot visualize. And I think that surprise is felt because the notion contradicts a model of creative production that proliferates in Western discourse on the subject. And crudely, this is the model of externalization, that the artist has an idea, then realizes it in the world. Its origin is probably with Aristotle and his theory that the forms of art pre-exist in the soul of the artist, and that creation entails the form entering from the maker into matter. We can see it in early modernity with, for example, Federico Zuccari and his definition, his differentiation between decennio interno, the thing in the mind of the artist, and the decennio esterno that follows. But we see the externalization model take on a recognizably modern form with the philosophical and social changes of the 18th century and the emergence of a distinctively psychological concept of the self. So, this is Joshua Reynolds. In his Royal Academy lectures of 1771, Reynolds gives a precise account of how the history painter should work from what he calls a mental picture. He says, whenever a story is related, every man forms a picture in his mind of the action and the expression of the persons employed. The power of representing this mental picture in canvas is what we call invention in the painter. And I think in this way, Reynolds is the culmination of a view that had been held for centuries, that artistic creation is really only a technical formality after the formation of an ideal design in the mind, that picture making must start with inner pictures. And of course, such a view cannot countenance an aphantasic artist. But of course, this wasn't the only account of picture making available, and an opposing model is brought out by psychologically informed approaches in the 20th century. So, with visual thinking in 1969, Rudolf Arnheim argued that reasoning and perceiving are not as distinct as philosophy has traditionally perceived them to be. So, a person who paints, writes, composes, or dances, Arnheim claims, does not externalize ideas, but rather thinks with his senses. Arnheim considers the case of someone drawing an elephant from memory and observes that if you ask the artist from what model he is drawing, he may deny convincingly that he has anything like an explicit picture of an animal in his mind. So, no mental pictures. It seems instead that the operation takes place in the perceived outside world on the drawing board. As the lines and colours appear, they look right or wrong to the draftsman, and they themselves seem to determine what he must do about them. So Arnheim's observation that the operation seems to take place on the drawing board is, I think, quite radical. And it predicts a view of drawing and creativity more generally than is influential in the early 21st century. This is the idea of extended cognition. That human thought is not actually limited to what takes place inside the skull, that can reside in processes in the outside world. For example, when we use a pen and paper to perform long multiplication, or we physically rearrange our Scrabble tiles to help us think of a word. Andy Clark, who first proposed the idea of extended cognition with David Chalmers in 1998, claimed that we should also consider the artist's sketchpad as an example of extended cognition. He says that the main reason artists sketch at all, rather than just imagining what they want and drawing it, is that mental imagery is inherently limited, because it is only what the imaginer wants it to be. He said, but by starting to draw the artist, by starting to draw, the artist begins a feedback loop in which each mark they make suggests possibilities for the next mark. The artist, he says, perceptually, not merely imaginatively, re-encounters visual forms, which he can then inspect, tweak, and re-sketch. In this way, a sketch pad, claims Clark, is more than just a tool, it is actually part of a unified, extended cognitive system. So, where does this leave aphantasic art? What we've seen is that in modern conceptualizations of drawing, at least, visualizing is not part of the process. The artist works perceptually, so the inability to visualize is no impediment. Furthermore, Clark's model is based on the limitedness of imagery per se, disregarding individual differences. But the aphantasics imagery is worse than limited, it's wholly unavailable. They especially are obligated to make marks in the outside world if they want to know what the thing they are thinking of looks like. They can fairly be said to have extended their minds to include the paper because it is used for something that their brains in particular find impossible. So what do we do with this, the externalizer thesis? Do we disregard it? I don't think so. I think we have to look at the reasons those holding to it have for doing so. For Reynolds, it was the weight of tradition and the influence of empiricist philosophy, undoubtedly, which held that the mind was composed of images. But also Reynolds' own psychological makeup. There are suggestions that Reynolds himself experienced vivid mental imagery in his assumption that every man forms pictures in his mind when hearing a story. Making that assumption quite possibly because he is taking his own experience to be everyone's. Imagery experience leads to an imagery disposition. That is to say, if you have it, you utilize it, as we've seen with our aphantasic artist. And if you don't have it, as we've seen with our aphantasic artist, you develop other means. Reynolds' theory of externalization makes sense, I think, as a description of how he, in particular, works. We approach the possibility, the conclusion, that the two theories of externalizing the mind's contents and extending the mind's working represent two different ways of creating. Informed by the culture of the time, but also by the mental makeup and predispositions of their inheritance.
Thank you very much.